Hello friends, welcome back. Hope you're having a great day so far, and craving some of the latest updates as well. So let us serve you three pieces of news today. We'll start with Starlink, as it engaged beta testers for Starlink Better Than Nothing in United States and Canada. Starlink is designed by SpaceX to provide high-speed network connectivity to those locations where there's low-quality connection or it's totally unavailable. For this Starlink network, SpaceX has already sent 15 batches of router satellites into orbit. At present, Starlink is ready to sign up network connection for the customers paying first. SpaceX officially started to provide beta Better Than Nothing over Canada and the United States of America. After continuing Starlink missions for the last 11 months, launching about 895 satellites, SpaceX has come to a position to provide internet connection in the US and Canada. In the first beta email, the company was offering a Better Than Nothing beta test to select people who have registered their interest through the Starlink website. The email reads, "As you can tell from the title, we're trying to lower your expectations." The email also gives information about the Starlink app launched on the App Store for both Android and iOS devices. The app is designed to help customers in installing the user terminal, set up the Starlink hardware, run speed tests, solve connectivity problems, and check obstructions which will disturb the router performance. In the email, cost of a user terminal, router, and monthly subscription were also given. Michael Baylor, creator of Next Spaceflight app, tweeted on the 27th of October, "Starlink has moved into invitation-only public beta. Pricing is $499 for the phased array antenna and router, and then a $99 monthly subscription." He also shared the email he got from SpaceX Starlink on Twitter. The Starlink beta invite email also explains that data speeds may vary from 50 megabits per second to 150 megabits per second, and latency or ping will be between 20 milliseconds and 40 milliseconds. There may be occasional interruptions in the network service. As we launch more satellites, install more ground stations, and improve our networking software, data speed, latency, and uptime will improve dramatically. For latency, we expect to achieve 16 milliseconds to 19 milliseconds by summer 2021, said the Starlink team. Starlink satellites are deployed in the lower Earth orbit, while the network providing satellites of other providers like Viasat and HughesNet were deployed in a distant geosynchronous orbit. For this reason, Starlink's network speeds will be 6 times faster than the older network companies, providing connectivity with a significantly lower latency. The cost of connection peripherals and monthly subscription fees of Starlink are comparable to traditional satellite providers such as Viasat and HughesNet. But still, the price is much, as Starlink User Terminal Factory has just started volume production. They're the first company doing this type of service. The phased array antennas were not produced in huge amount, so there is a high price. But Starlink is now enlarging their production unit. Space reporter Eric Ralph tweeted on the 27th of October, giving hope to US and Canadian citizens that, "Worth remembering that the Starlink User Terminal Factory is in the very early stages of startup to mass produce a technology that's never been mass produced before. It's safe to say that price could drastically decrease as production ramps." It's not yet clear how soon the new beta testers can expect to receive their equipment. SpaceX is preparing itself to ship Starlink user terminals and set up packs to beta users as soon as they place their order. Let's move on to the next segment to discuss a news where SpaceX is replacing 2 rocket engines for its next astronaut launch for NASA. Steve Stitch, manager of NASA's Commercial Crew Program, said, "If all goes according to plan, NASA and SpaceX will conduct a flight readiness review for Crew 1 on the 30th of October, Friday, and start loading propellant this weekend into the Crew Dragon, which its riders have named Resilience. SpaceX is replacing 2 engines of the rocket to be used in Crew Dragon mission on the 14th of November. This measure was taken after the scrutiny of Falcon 9 rocket problem during a GPS satellite launch on the 2nd of October. On the 28th of October, Wednesday, Hans Konigsmann, SpaceX's Vice President of Build and Flight Reliability, said that the investigation of the 2nd of October abort traced the issue to 2 of the 9 Merlin engines on the Falcon 9's first stage. Those 2 Merlins retained residue of a masking lacquer, designed to protect sensitive parts during anti-corrosion anodizing treatment. The vendor performing the treatment didn't manage to remove all of the lacquer afterward, and some of it ended up blocking 0.06-inch wide vent holes for valves in two of the Merlins that were supposed to power the two-stage Falcon 9 Skyward on the 2nd of October. SpaceX found signs of a similar issue with two of the engines of the Crew 1 Falcon 9's first stage, as well as one Merlin in the first stage of the booster scheduled to loft the Sentinel 6, Michael Frelick Earth Observing Satellite for NASA on the 10th of November. So, SpaceX is now swapping out all of those affected Merlins for ones known to be free of masking lacquer residue. Koenigsmann said, SpaceX conducted investigation and troubleshooting with NASA and Space Force. It led to a really good review and a really good anomaly resolution that, in my opinion, makes a better vehicle and a better engine going forward, he said. SpaceX's safety systems worked properly on October 2nd, noticing the anomaly in time and aborting the launch, he said. And a liftoff that day may not have been disastrous, Koenigsmann added. The Falcon 9 might have experienced a hard start caused by introducing various fluids, igniter fluid, liquid oxygen, and kerosene in the wrong order in the affected engines. The Falcon 9 should be ready in time for the planned 14th of November launch of Crew 1, NASA officials said during Wednesday's news conference. Though they stressed that the mission will launch when it's ready, and are not constrained by an arbitrary timeline. Steve Stitch said that the four astronauts, Michael Hopkins, Soichi Noguchi, Shannon Walker, and Victor Glover, are currently in soft quarantine at their homes and will enter a more stringent quarantine on Halloween. SpaceX holds a $2.6 billion contract with NASA to fly at least six operational missions, the first of which will be Crew 1, 2, and from the station. In our last segment, we'll discuss some news from Russia as they just launched GLONASS navigation satellite. On the 24th of October, a Soyuz booster and Fregat upper stage successfully deployed a modified Russian GLONASS navigation satellite to an orbital path about 12,000 miles above the Earth. The Russian Ministry of Defense said that the mission was launched at 3:08 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time on Saturday using a Russian-made Soyuz 21B rocket from the Plesetsk Cosmodrome. The new satellite joined 24 active navigation spacecraft in the GLONASS fleet sent by Russia earlier. The U.S. military's Global Positioning System, GPS, is an acquaintance with the Russian GLONASS satellite group. Plesetsk Cosmodrome is a military-controlled launch base situated about 800 kilometers north of Moscow. The satellite launched Saturday, the 24th of October 2020, is the third spacecraft in Russia's GLONASS K series of navigation satellites. The first two GLONASS K satellites were launched in 2011 and 2014. The GLONASS K satellites weigh around 935 kilograms, which is less than the earlier generation of GLONASS M satellites. Engineers designed this K series to last longer and transmit more accurate navigation signals. These crafts are lighter in weight, generate more electrical power, and are based on an unpressurized Express 1000K built bus by ISS Rzhetnev in Zeleznogorsk, Russia. Replacing the orbital constellation with GLONASS-K spacecraft will ensure the stable operation of the Russian navigation system and increase the accuracy of its navigation determinations up to tens of centimeters, the Russian Defense Ministry said in a statement. It was expected that the Russian Ministry of Defense would name the new GLONASS satellite Cosmos 2547, keeping similarly with the naming scheme of Russian military spacecraft. But it didn't happen. In the previous version of GLONASS, it has a lifetime of 7 years. The new GLONASS-K satellite is expected to operate for 10 years and features a new civilian L-band signal with 5 navigation channels. The GLONASS-K spacecraft will also help in the international Kaspis-SARSAT search and rescue network, Russian officials said. A change was introduced in the GLONASS-K design due to international sanctions on Russia. These international sanctions provoked Russia to use more Russian-built equipment on Saturday's GLONASS-K launch than the previous GLONASS spacecraft. The network is managed by the Russian military, but is also used by civilians worldwide. This network requires 24 satellites in service divided among 3 orbital planes to provide global navigation coverage. According to the 26th of October report, the GLONASS fleet consists of 24 active satellites, plus the new spacecraft launched on the 24th of October. three more satellites are operating as a spare, undergoing maintenance and performing flight tests. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.